Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is John Huang. I'm your host, and I'm a program manager at Microsoft. I'm very pleased to have with me Torsten Graf from the SQL Server engineering team to discuss the data warehouse workload for the Azure VM. For the next 45 minutes, we'll do a quick introduction, and then we'll provide an overview of the data warehouse market and the Microsoft data warehouse offerings. We'll provision the new data warehouse VM, and also finally, we'll share the data migration best practices. So let's get started. Again, my name is John Huang. I'm a senior programmer with the SQL Server Azure CAT team since 2008, working on the MPP appliance solution for the large-scale workload. I have over 20 years experience in providing software solutions from manufacturing, retail, and healthcare industry. I'm currently focusing on the persistent data storage solution for the on-premise, cloud, and the hybrid scenario. And Torsten?
Hello, everyone. My name is Torsten Grabs. I'm also a program manager here at Microsoft. It's great to be here today. I've been with the SQL Server team since 2004 in various roles in development and program management. I'm currently working on modern data warehousing workloads in the cloud, and Elasticsearch for SQL Azure, Azure DB. Previously, I've worked in areas such as query notifications, XML optimizations in SQL Server, and some data warehousing work as well.
Okay, great. So, Torsten, as you know, Microsoft made great investment in offering the full spectrum of data warehouse products for various workloads. Could you share with us some of the current product offerings that we have?
Yeah, let's take a quick look into what is out there. And I've structured it into two parts. So you see on the left side of this slide, you see our on-premise offerings. And on the right-hand side, you see our cloud-based offerings in Azure. And let me start at the bottom. So our on-premise offerings for data warehousing include SQL Server Enterprise Edition, and specifically Enterprise Edition because it comes with a lot of the data warehousing-related features. Also for big data customers that want to do some compute or semi-structured data processing, we have the Windows distribution for Hadoop, which I'm showing here. That's the HDP part. And then if you go to the upper left-hand corner, you see our appliance-based offerings. And there we have two offerings in the market. The first one is the SQL Server Parallel Data Warehouse Appliance, which comes with the Poly-based technology that allows you to integrate between the relational processing on one side and the Hadoop-based semi-structured data processing on the other side. So that's a scale-out, shared nothing, parallel data warehouse appliance. Also, we offer an SMP appliance, which is called FastTrack, with a number of different hardware vendors. That's SQL Server-based, but based on the Enterprise Edition again. Now let's jump over into the right part of this slide, which is our offerings in Azure in the Microsoft Cloud today. Again, starting at the bottom, you'll see that we already released general purpose SQL Server images in Azure VMs, and those are ready for any general purpose SQL Server deployments. And we also have the HD Insight service for any kind of big data processing in our cloud. Now, what we're going to focus on today is what you see in the upper right-hand quadrant of this slide, which are the appliance-like optimized VM images for the data warehousing workload. And that's based on the SQL Server general purpose images that we have in Azure. But those images are specifically tuned and optimized for data warehousing as a workload. Let me show you a little bit how this fits into the bigger picture of our different offerings on-premise and cloud and what the characteristics are that you have for these different offerings. So looking at this slide, on the left side, you basically have our on-premise offerings, SQL Server. You as a customer own the physical hardware, the machines on which you run SQL Server, run your data warehouse. That gives you the highest control over what you do on those machines and the highest control also over the specific configuration. However, you're not benefiting from any of the cloud cost benefits. So once you've acquired the hardware, you're stuck with it and you need to keep running it. One step further then is the red part that you see here on the slide, which is basically using virtualization and a private cloud, and you can run SQL Server on VMs in your own private cloud and also use appliances like the Parallel Data Warehouse appliance or the FastTrack appliances. That gives you a little bit less control over what you do because some aspects are pre-configured. However, you still own the underlying hardware. The next step in this progression here is jumping into the cloud and using Windows Azure infrastructure as a service using virtual machines in Azure for your SQL Server workloads. And that's the green part that you see here on the slide. And that still gives you quite a bit of control because you can pretty much configure and manage the SQL Server instances that are running on your virtual machines in Azure. Now, taking the last step here on this slide, it takes you into the platform as a service offerings with Azure SQL DB, where a lot of the management aspects for your database are being taken care of automatically by the platform. And that's where you probably give up most of the control, but you're also sharing a lot of the infrastructure and the underlying hardware with other customers, so you're getting the best cost benefit in that area. The focus for us today is on the green part, the infrastructure as a service virtual machines, and specifically the ones that we have tuned and optimized for data warehousing so that you get an appliance-like experience when you deploy them in Azure.
So could you go into a little more detail about the value proposition of this new VM data warehouse? And how is it different from the other VM that we have out there, images that we have out there?
Yeah, happy to. That's a great question. So here you see... in one big picture, the different offerings that we have around VM images for data warehousing. The first one is for SQL Server 2012, and the other one is for SQL Server 2014 CTP2. They have a couple of parts in common. They're both based on Enterprise Edition. They're both using Windows Server 2012, and both of them have been optimized using the fast-track optimizations and the fast-track best practices that we already used to tune and optimize appliances, data warehousing appliances for on-premise workloads. We've basically just taken those learnings and best practices and applied it to Azure and our VMs in the cloud. Both of them give you the ability to attach up to 16 terabyte of disks with the A7 or the XLVM sizes. So those are the parts that are in common between the two different images that we have in the Azure Gallery. Now let's talk a little bit about the differences between these two VMs. So for the SQL Server 2012 VM, it's obviously based on the SQL 2012 image, and we are recommending that for a VM size A6 with 5 Azure disks. That's the configuration where we have gotten the best performance with the fast-track optimizations and the fast-track workload. So that's what we have been optimizing for SQL Server 2012. And it can take you up to data warehouse sizes of up to 400 gigabytes in data size. And that's up to this size you stay within the fast track best practices. Obviously, you can accommodate much larger data sizes, but then you are no longer in the sweet spot from a fast track perspective. Now let's talk a little bit about the SQL Server 2014 VM image as well. Obviously, it's based on the SQL Server 2014 CTP2 bits. We are recommending that for the A7 VM size and with up to 9 Azure disks. And this can take you up to 1 terabyte in terms of data warehouse sizes, and you are still up to 1 terabyte within the fast-track configuration and fast-track best practices. The reason for the difference in the data size between these two images is that SQL Server 2014 comes with a number of important features for data warehousing. First of all, I want to mention the cluster column store index, which is new in SQL Server 2014, and it allows you to compress your data warehouse and keep it in memory. That's also the reason why we decided to go with the A7 VM, which has the larger memory size for the SQL Server 2014. If you're using cluster column store index, you can fit most of your data warehouse into main memory, and it gives you much, much better performance, particularly in Azure. There are a couple of other features as well that are important from a data warehousing perspective that I want to mention in this context for SQL Server 2014, and that's incremental statistics for partition tables and also a new cardinality estimation framework that we have put into the product. Both of them work very well and are designed for data warehousing workloads. So those are, in a nutshell, the two different offerings that you will find in the Windows Azure Gallery.
Okay, so next, I think Torsten is going to demo on how to provision the VM.
Yeah, let's do that. Right. Let's jump into Internet Explorer. And I'm logged into my Windows Azure subscription here. And you see a couple of virtual machines that I've already provisioned. But let's start from scratch and actually go and stand up a new virtual machine from the Azure Gallery. And it takes me into this dialog where I can choose an image. Let's narrow down on the SQL Server images. And what you see here are different SQL Server images. Here's the one for data warehousing for SQL Server 2014. And here is the one for SQL Server 2012, again, optimized for data warehousing. So those are the two images that we have in the gallery that are optimized for data warehousing. Let's take the one for SQL Server 2012 and take the A6 offering, put me in as a user. Let's use an existing cloud service for this. Let's use my existing storage account for this. And let's go with the defaults for all the other options, including the ones here. And let's finish this dialog. And you can see that I have a new VM that's in the provisioning phase right now. It's called TG Demo. And it will take a couple of minutes to stand up that virtual machine for us. So why don't we jump back into the presentation while we wait for this to finish and talk a little bit about the highlights of these virtual machines. What are you getting? What is the configuration in more detail? So one of the key benefits that I really want to call out is that for those virtual machines, they're 100% compatible with the functionality and the surface area for SQL Server on-premise. So whatever you've done already for your on-premise offerings, functionally, it's the same for those virtual machines. Obviously, you're running those virtual machines in the cloud. So based on that, you may see some differences in performance because you are sharing the infrastructure with other cloud customers. One key benefit of these virtual machines is we have tried to make the deployment and the provisioning process as simple as possible for you. And there are two ways that you can do that, and I'll explain those in a little bit more detail. For right now, just keep in mind there's one way that basically takes you all the way through the Azure portal to deploy and configure those virtual machines. The other one allows you to deploy them in a fully automated way through PowerShell. And that's a great way for those that need to provision a large number of these virtual machines. You can automate that process by basically crafting your own PowerShell scripts to stand up those virtual machines for data warehousing. So let's take a little bit of time to discuss the different configuration options and the kind of tuning that we have done for those virtual machine images. So based on the fast track best practices and guidance, there's a number of startup options for SQL Server and also TraceFlex that are recommended for data warehousing workloads. And we have basically automated the configuration of SQL Server such that those configuration options are automatically being taken care of for you. So for instance, just to give a couple of examples, we are using the -E startup option for SQL Server, and we're also using TraceFlex 1117 as pre-configured option on the instance. The memory settings are also optimized based on FastTrack guidance. We are reserving 92% of the available memory in the virtual machine. That's typically where you see the best performance for relational data warehousing workloads. In addition to that, we have also taken great care of provisioning your I/O subsystem to the extent that this is possible in a virtualized environment like the cloud. So we are using storage spaces to abstract from the underlying Azure disks, and we are basically putting the Azure disks that you provision under storage spaces, and then we are laying down the database files on the storage spaces disks. That makes managing your I/O system, your disks, much, much easier because there's just a single point that you need to go to, which is the storage spaces. The sizing that we've talked about, like the 400 gigabytes for the A6 and SQL 2012 and 1 terabyte for SQL 2014, that's based on the fast track guidance where we have where we hit the sweet spot between CPU that we have, CPU power that we have on the virtual machine, and the I/O subsystem, the Azure disks that we've attached to the virtual machines. Once you provision the disks and the VMs, then we have an automated tool that's running in the background and basically waiting for the disks to show up for the VMs, and I'll show how that looks like. And then once the disks are available, it will automatically create the storage space for it, put down the data and the log files, and optimize that database file placement on the disks and the storage spaces. I mentioned that there are a couple of different ways how you can provision your data warehousing VMs. The first one is the portal-based approach, and that's what you've just seen in the little demo that I showed. And it's a great way for first-time users to just learn about the product and get guidance through the provisioning process. And all of those interactions actually can be done through the portal. So if you're just new to this space, then that's a great way for you to get started. And if you look into the little animation that or the little picture that I have on the slide here, basically you pick the gallery image. And if you are the portal-based users, you go through the portal provisioning process for the actual VM. That's what I just showed in the demo. Then the next step for you, and you can do that through the portal as well, is attaching the disks for your VM. And once the disks are provisioned for your VM, then our automated configuration kicks in, and it takes a couple of minutes. And after the configuration is complete, you have a fully optimized, fully tuned SQL Server VM for data warehousing. Now, if you need to do this a couple of times, you will find it cumbersome to go and click through the portal UI for every VM that you want to stand up. If that's the case, then you can use a PowerShell approach, which is particularly appealing if you have repeat deployments. It's completely scripted. We have a script available in the Azure Script Center, and here's a link on the slides that you can follow that takes you to the scripts. And the script is leveraging the image that we've put into the Azure Gallery, and it also automates the disk provisioning process. So if you look into the picture on the slide here, it basically takes the gallery image and provisions the VM and also automatically attaches the disks to it. And then our configuration background process picks up and produces the fully optimized, fully tuned data warehousing image. So obviously, the scripted approach, it's a script that's publicly available. You can tweak it and tune it according to your specific needs.
So it's likely that your the image that you just provisioned is probably complete right now. So I believe that the next demo you're going to show us is how to add the disk.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's take a quick look and see whether the VM is ready. It doesn't look like that, so it probably is going to take a couple more minutes for that VM to complete, which is fine. I've already provisioned an image here, which you see down here, which is up and running. Let's connect to this real quick to see what's going on. So here's our first login, basically, into a freshly provisioned data warehousing VM. And it brings up the MSDN page that tells you precisely how to finalize the configuration and the optimization. As I mentioned, the only step that you need to do is to add Azure disks to your VM. And the page that we automatically pop up when you log in explains this in detail for you. One thing to keep in mind is that in order to stay within the fast track best practices, we are very, very carefully looking at the amount of memory that's available in the CPU that's available on the VMs. So you will see that different VM sizes expect different numbers of disks to be attached. So that's something to be mindful of if you go into the portal. To do that. So let's do this real quick for this virtual machine that I have here. And note that I used an ASICS VM size. So this VM expects five disks, five Azure disks to be attached. to finalize the configuration. So the way that you would do this through the portal is to attach an empty disk down here from the attached disk dialog. And the size that you need to use for the data warehousing images is 1,023 gigabytes. Set the host caching preferences to none, just to make sure that you have durability for the transactions that you do. And now for the A6 VM that we're working with here right now, you would basically need to go through this dialog five times to attach the five disks. That can be quite cumbersome. So let me show you a way how you can actually do this much more quickly. And the way to do that is to go into Windows Azure PowerShell. What I've done here is I've added my Azure account so that I can run PowerShell commands against my Azure subscription. I've registered my subscription, Windows Azure internal consumption, and my storage account. And let's try to connect to this VM that's out there and running. And this seems to have worked. So let's look at the VM. So this is the VM that we just connected to. It's called GGDemo Raw. Has no disks attached. And now let me go and take a couple of these commands here, and we'll look at them in just a second, and plug them into the PowerShell window here. And you saw them just fly by. Look at this one up here. So basically what it says is, I want to add an Azure Data Disk, a new one, with 1023 gigabytes in size, host caching disabled, and then a couple of labels and parameters for it, and attach this disk, add this disk to the VM that we just got in this variable. So, and I've basically issued five of these add disk commands for that VM, and they're waiting to get deployed. So let's deploy them. And the great thing about this is that you can actually do this in one shot. So basically get all the, get all the disks provisioned.
With using the PowerShell, is it doing it in sequential order, or is it adding all five disks in parallel?
No, the great thing about PowerShell is that it's actually adding all of these disks in parallel. That gives you much better performance also as compared to doing it through the Azure portal, because in the Azure portal, you can obviously just do one at a time.
Right.
Here, you're doing all five of them in one shot.
Great. That's great. Saves us a lot of time. Right?
Yeah. And what I've seen by just basically working with it, it can take you easily 10, 15 minutes to do that in the portal.
Right.
Here, it usually completes within a minute or two for all the disks.
Great.
And it's independent of the number of disks. So if you would go for an even larger VM size, so let's say for an A7, right, where you have to attach nine disks, this is really a great way to speed up this process of attaching disks. Okay, great. So you see that the process just finished. So all the disks should be attached now. That puts the VM in a place, in a position, where our automation for the configuration can pick up.
Right.
And it will run in the background for a couple of minutes to provision and tune SQL Server for data warehousing. Let's keep the VM running for a couple of minutes to complete that optimization process.
Okay.
And then we'll log into the machine again and see what's been going on.
Okay.
Let's do that.
Right.
Let's minimize some of those windows here.
So while we have the VM configuration running in the background, Torsten is going to discuss about what some of the options of migrating the on-premise data into this Azure VM that we just provisioned.
Yeah, and that's really a key question that we have seen with a lot of customers. And particularly for smaller data warehouses or data marts, they find it very attractive to use the cloud for their data marts. In particular, if they just need to run that data mart periodically or for just a couple of days to run queries or to run reports. So the key question here is, how do I get my data mart, my data warehouse, from on-premise typically into Azure, into the cloud? And there are a couple of different options that we have looked into to find out what's the best way to do that. And it starts with just SQL Server Integration Services, which is a great tool to do these kind of things. Also, there is the ability to backup and restore a database using a URL as the backup device. That's another very simple option that you can use. And then there are a couple of tools out there that are really helpful in this particular context. One of them is Azure Copy. Obviously, what you can do is you can backup your data warehouse on-premise and then take the backup files and copy them into the cloud using Azure Copy. The other approach is that you create virtual disks through backup and restore, put your backups on those, and then either use Azure Copy to move the VHDs into the cloud, or you can actually ship the disks to Azure and have them mounted. The last approach, obviously, if you can afford to take your data warehouse offline for some time, is to detach your database files, copy them over into Azure, and then reattach them. One of the key factors that's governing your experience for the migration is how thick is your pipe between the place where you have your data warehouse, so typically your data center or on-premise server, and the cloud. And the speed or the bandwidth that you have to upload your backups or your VHDs, that will pretty much tell you how long it's going to take for you to do the migration. Now, obviously, it helps if you can shrink or minimize the amount of data that you have to transfer. So think again about using a couple of great tools that will help you to keep the size of your databases under control. Again, thinking of SQL Server 2014, column store indexes are a great way to reduce the amount of data through the compression that you get with the column store index. Another step that you can take is truncating your logs before you go through the migration process or shrinking your database files before you do a detach and attach migration. So those are some of the things that you can take to reduce the amount of time that you spend on the wire transmitting the data from on-premise into the cloud. So let's look at a performance comparison between some of these different approaches. Mm-hmm. So what I've put together on this slide here is for two data warehouse sizes, one with 100 gigabytes, the other one with 1 terabyte, I'm comparing the performance of the different approaches that we just discussed. So one of them is backup and restore through a URL device. The next one is backup and restore using VHDs and using AZ Copy to move the VHDs over into the cloud. And then backup and restore with just files, again using AZ Copy. And the last one, the purple one, is AZ Copy with detach and attach. And you see that all of them are more or less in the same ballpark if you're dealing with smaller data warehouse sizes. So it really doesn't matter that much. If simplicity is a concern for you and you want to minimize the number of steps that you have to go through and your data warehouse is pretty small, you really think about using the backup and restore with a URL device because it's a very, very simple process. You basically just invoke the backup command, you point to the URL that you want to use, and then you restore from that URL into the data warehousing virtual machine. All of the other approaches require at least one more step, and that's a place where obviously exceptions or errors can occur. So if your data warehouse is small enough, think about using the backup and restore to URL. Now, if you look at the larger data warehouse sizes, we have a clear favorite, which is detach and attach in this case. But we are shrinking the database files for that. Be mindful when you do that, as it may introduce fragmentation to your databases.
So one of the things that stand out is that huge differences in the timing on the URL method for the 1 terabyte. Could you explain to us what causes the difference?
Yeah, that's a great question. We were surprised by that as well when we looked into this. And really the reason for that is that with the backup to URL command, excuse me, you can only configure one URL as the target device. And that basically puts you into a place where only one threat is writing into that single device. For all of the other approaches, in particularly for the copy process, we're using multiple files that we could copy in parallel. Mm-hmm. And that option just does not exist as of now with backup and restore to URL. And it speeds up all of the other approaches quite dramatically. So that was something that really has helped us. And that's something that you should also think about when you migrate your data warehouse. Think about which parts of the migration process you can actually parallelize. In particular, when your data warehouse is big, it may help you really cut down the time that it takes for the migration. Mm-hmm. So based on that, really, for anything in the order of several hundreds of gigabytes in terms of data warehouse size, I would rule out the backup and restore to URL because it's just probably taking way too long for you. So think about using the other approaches instead.
Okay, so that's take us to the next question. So I have several scenarios that I can migrate my data up there. Can you share some best practices on what scenario, what workload I can use each one of these methods?
Yeah, I'm happy to. And the split that we've come up with is structured around the size of your data warehouse. If your data warehouse is smaller than a gigabyte or has less than a million rows, then really think about using SQL Server integration services. It's very simple. It's very straightforward. In particular, if you're already familiar with integration services, I wouldn't bother learning a new tool if your data warehouse is small enough. Also, if at some point you have to move dimension tables that tend to be smaller, then SSIS integration services is a great option to do that. For larger data warehouses that are larger than 1 gigabyte but less than 10 gigabytes, as we discussed, the backup and restore through URL has actually acceptable performance, and it's a simple, straightforward two-step process. So I would go with that if my data warehouse is less than 10 gigabytes. Now, for everything that's larger than 10 gigabytes, think about using detach and attach if you can take your data warehouse offline. If that's not an option for you, then go think about using backup and restore instead to minimize the offline periods. Also, try to truncate the logs in both of these cases. It will help you reduce the size of the data that you have to move across the wire. And consider shrinking your database files, particularly with a detach-attach approach. Now, as mentioned previously, column store helps big time to reduce the overall amount of data that's persisted on disk through the compression that you get with a column store index. So I would recommend this for all the data warehouses out there. And so that's one place where compression really, really helps. Another place where you might think about compression is backup and restore using compressed backups. We have tried this option and found that it actually doesn't give you that much better performance. It increases the time that it takes to generate the backups in the first place quite a bit. But the savings, on the other hand, are pretty small. And that's particularly true if you're using the column store index with compression already. Then the additional compression that you're getting from a compressed backup is super small, and the additional time that you spend in the backup process to do the compression is not worth the benefits that you get in terms of the reduction of size. As mentioned, if you are going through the migration process, obviously the key factor on all of this is how large is the bandwidth that you have between the place where you've produced your backup files or where your database files live, and the cloud. And if you can find a place where you have the best upload bandwidth, go with that place for the actual migration process, for the data movement process into the cloud.
Okay, so let's go back and check to see if we finished with the optimization process. Can you just basically show us what that new VM looks like?
Yeah, let's go back into Azure here. This was the VM that we went with. Okay. Let's connect to this guy. There we are, back again in the VM. Let's just bring up Explorer and see what has happened here. So what you see is, in addition to the regular SQL Server disks that you get with the vanilla SQL Server images, which are the disk drive C and the temporary storage drive D, you see two additional drives, drive F and drive G. The first one is about 4 terabytes in size, so four of the five Azure disks that we provisioned for that VM vent into this F drive. And the fifth one, the fifth terabyte that we provisioned, went into the G drive. And in terms of the configuration, all the data files for your data warehouse should go into the F drive, and we have provisioned the G drive as the log drive for your data warehouse. Let's also look into Server Manager and see what has happened here. And look into the storage pools. And you should see that, basically the log drive and the data drive, they're showing up as storage spaces. And you can see that for the data drive, we actually have these four disks, these four physical Azure disks attached to that storage pool. And those are just four of the Azure disks that we just attached to that VM. And that's a great way for you to manage your storage. There's just one drive plus the log drive that you have to worry about, and you can manage everything through storage pools. We have also looked a little bit into the performance implications of using storage pools, and we have seen that it's about 10 to 15% in terms of a performance hit that the additional layer for storage pool adds in terms of latency. But we think that this is totally worth the little performance hit because the manageability benefits are much larger. So let's go and look into the actual SQL Server configuration and bring up SQL Server Management Studio and look at a couple of the configuration options that we've put in place for the SQL Server instance that's running on the machine. I was already telling you about the startup parameters and some of the trace factor settings and the memory settings that we are using. So let's take a quick look at that once Management Studio shows up. Okay, and so one of the additional benefits of using storage spaces while we're waiting for the Management Studio to show up is obviously that you can manage everything through the storage spaces console here. And just to complete the picture here, I was just showing the data drive previously. Let's take a quick look at the log drive. You see that the fifth Azure disk is actually used here as a physical disk to power the log drive.
So what are some of the performance number in terms of the network, the disk I/O, memory, CPU that we should be expecting working on this VM image?
Yeah, that's a great question. And obviously a key factor here is that all of the disks, the physical disks that are attached to that VM are actually network disks that live in Azure storage. Okay. So for any physical I/O that you have to do, you are crossing the Azure network. And that has implications in terms of the latency, but particularly around the I/O bandwidth that you're going to get. Right. And what we have seen in our performance evaluations is that for queries, for read-only workloads, you're getting about 100 to 120 megabytes with these VMs that we have configured for query workloads.
Right.
You can increase the performance here by just using the cluster column store index again, because more of your data will fit into main memory. Okay. The more data you can fit into main memory, the more physical I/O across the network you can avoid. So again, best practice, use cluster column store index for your data warehousing workload wherever you can.
Okay, great tips.
So in terms of the CPU, we are just using the regular CPUs that you're getting on these virtual machines. So there are no real considerations or differences here as compared to a private cloud virtualized data warehouse. Okay. That's pretty much the same experience that we have seen there. Really, the key difference is around the physical I/O across the network. Okay. So let's take a quick look here at the configuration of the SQL Server instance on that virtual machine. You'll see that the database settings are pre-configured so that the data goes to the mount point, the C drive, which basically points to the data drive in storage spaces. And the log is pre-configured to go to the mount point for the log drive in storage spaces. Mm-hmm. So when you create your database files, they will land in the right places on the disks that we have pre-provisioned for those VMs. So you don't have to worry about that. Also, the other configuration setting is around the memory size. And here you see that we have configured the maximum server memory to 92% of the available physical memory in the machine. And that's the setting here for the A6 that you see here. That's one of the settings that we have taken care of. Now, let's fire up a query and do a DBCC trace status real quick. And trace status shows you the trace flag that I mentioned previously, the trace flag 1117, again, which goes back to the fast track best practices. Again, that's pre-configured for you so that you don't have to worry about that. Okay. So just to wrap up to what we see here, basically, in 15 or maybe 20 minutes, we have pretty much stood up a full-blown virtual machine tuned and optimized and configured for data warehousing with SQL Server. So if you think about the typical experience that customers used to have on-premise, that was quite a cumbersome process.
Yes.
You first had to decide what's the hardware that you have to use for this. You had to purchase the hardware. Then you had to think carefully through what are the configuration options and what's the storage system that I want to put onto that machine. So all of these questions are pretty much answered out of the box for our customers through those virtual machines in the Azure Gallery. So I've really done a lot of the heavy lifting around the provisioning process for data warehouses. We have done that for you through the Azure VM Gallery. And it's just, it just feels like having an appliance in the cloud. It's a very similar experience. All right.
So I think to wrap up is we have additional resources for you to take a look at. Please download this deck and then click on the following links there so you can learn a little more about all the data warehouse, the fast track, and IaaS images. And I think just to wrap up, I think that basically we have about a few more minutes, so let's ask a few more Q&A questions. So I think that we have here. So one of the questions that we have is that if I have data that do not fit into the 9 disk, and I need to put additional disks, 10, 11, 12, and so on, can Data Warehouse IaaS handle it?
You can handle it. It's very similar to an appliance experience that you would have on-premise. So think about getting an on-premise appliance. It comes basically pre-configured with a number of disks.
Right.
The same is true for our data warehouse optimized images in Azure.
Mm-hmm.
We expect a certain number of disks to be attached as part of the pre-configuration.
Right.
Now, if you need more storage, you can go ahead and manually add additional disks to your VM.
Okay.
Obviously, the auto configuration will not pick them up, but you can go ahead and manually add them to storage spaces as additional physical disks, and then you'll benefit from the larger storage amount that you have through those additional disks. So there, you can do that. There are some manual steps involved into that at this point.
Okay. What about can you attach existing disk VHD with the database data attached to the data warehouse VM?
You can attach them to the data warehouse VM. Nothing precludes that. However, what you need to be mindful of is if you attach these additional disks that have the VHDs on it, they will the database files will not live in storage spaces again. So if you want to basically put them into storage spaces, there are some manual steps, additional steps that you need to take care of in order to put them into the right place.
Okay. One final question. What's the upload speed that you see out there, and how do you handle the scenario where the client to the Azure data center bandwidth is narrow?
Well, that's a really tough spot. So what we have seen with our own evaluations was an upload speed around or bandwidth around 60 megabytes per second. Mm-hmm. Now, we might be in a good place here at Microsoft, basically sitting in our labs. We might get a fairly good pipe to the Azure data centers. Now, if you have a substantially smaller pipe and less bandwidth for copying the data, one option that you can think of is actually shipping physical disks to Azure and have those physical disks with VHDs mounted as Azure disks for you. And if you have a large data warehouse and very little bandwidth, that might actually be the best option for you to get your data migrated.
Okay. So we are running out of time, and let's do a quick recap. So today we discussed the current offering of the Microsoft Data Warehouse Stacks. We provisioned the Data Warehouse optimized VM and also finally shared the data migration best practices. On behalf of the Microsoft Virtual Academy team, Torsten, we thank you very much for watching and have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.